Please take a seat if you can. Come on down, take a seat. We're about to get started. There are still seats up here, near the front. All right, welcome. Did you all enjoy your mystery hunt? Yeah, it's great to be back in person. We are your directors for this year's hunt from Teammate. I'm Brian.
I'm Catherine.
And I just want to say I'm super excited to be part of this and to be part for so grateful for all these guys here and just for the opportunity that we had to present sort of just the hunt that we could run here and just for all of the interaction that we would be able to see with all of you and hope that you had a lot of fun while solving our hunt. All right.
We're not gonna take too much longer and just jump straight into it. First up is our story director, Liam, talking about the story and the plot overview.
Hello, thank you for solving our completely normal museum hunt. All right, so let's get started with the. Just clicking there, we'll do it. So the story began during kickoff when we introduced our fully automated puzzle writing artificial intelligence, Mate. And Mate wrote a really excellent puzzle hunt themed around the Museum of Interesting Things. And we had rounds based on an atrium, art, natural history, world history, and science. And here you can see Mate. Unfortunately, Mate experienced some unexpected load issues, which you took advantage of to promptly ignore our excellent hunt and break out into the puzzle factory where all the puzzles get made. And you explored the office and basement of the factory and you fiddled with the guts of the machinery and you found an unfinished and glitchy museum around the Hall of Innovation. You discovered in the factory that Teammate had dumpster drives in the basement which contained old discarded AIs, and we had in fact penned multiple mates. And you learned that Mate was crashing and burning out by solving the museum and needed help writing Mystery Hunt. And you met with a ghost in the machinery who told you that they needed to be reconnected to the factory, which led into the reactivation. Using this information, you reactivated the old AIs by plugging their drives into the computer and breaking the encryption by finding their names, so you could have the old AIs help Mate write Mystery Hunt. Unfortunately for you, Teammate caught wind of this and did not want you messing around with our systems. As a result of your chicanery, Teammate panicked and shut down the Mystery Hunt to prevent the museum from being filled with weird puzzles, because we all know weird and experimental puzzles are just the worst. How do I get this? Just click it.
I can notice some weird things going on with the museum. Just drop the act. You've been in the factory for the last 30 hours.
Oh, all right. Yeah, we've been noticing some weird things with the factory. What's going on?
You went through our garbage? You stole our... You messed with our finely tuned computer systems?
It was like that when we Me? Me? You do it?
No, no, we don't. Tell us, please.
Those drives you had, they had AIs in them. And those AIs, they made the weirdest puzzles ever. That's why we quarantined them. And now they're connected to the system.
We had no choice but to call the plug.
All right. However, meet the rejects. However, the shutdown didn't go quite as planned. You and Worm, one of the AIs, you picked up the scraps and turned the factory back on. And the AIs came online one by one and wrote their own strange and unique rounds in place of mate, which you solved and helped them complete. And at the end of each of these rounds, you helped them install feature requests in the factory, which helped improve it for this and all future mystery hunts. Finally, you restored the museum hunt and revived Mate, who had a feature request of their own. After solving for the greatest common factory, you embarked on the final runaround where you used the factory to build a new puzzle of your own, which came in the form of a suspiciously coin-like object. The AIs unanimously decided to take a vacation. And with that, we'd like to talk about hunt structure, so I'll kick it over to our editors.
Hello, everyone. So I gotta keep this quick because I have less than 10 minutes, and apparently this one is very complex. So I'm gonna have to speed through some of the stuff. So at the start, we kind of had the museum theme going on, and solvers have access to the atrium. And if you solve a couple of puzzles, you unlock the science round. So normally, what would happen is you would solve more puzzles, unlock more rounds. But as Liam said, this was not to be. You had your solving experience interrupted by Mate. So early in the hunt, what solvers would see would be an animation loading before every single puzzle would load. The animation time would increase slowly from 1 second all the way up to 30 seconds. And at some point, your puzzle would just fail to load. This would be a way for you to kind of focus on this animation. So the way we implemented it was to have solvers, kind of have their attention diverted towards this animation. And when those puzzles became inaccessible, we would basically have all your attention on this animation. So hopefully that's what happened. So to solve this puzzle, what you have to notice is that the animation requires you to, the animation has several puzzle pieces in different colors coming in from the sides. And if you look at the different colors, it would spell out the word stop. And if you submitted that into the answer checker, you would see a portal open to the void, and you would go into the puzzle factory. So I want to talk a bit about the design of this puzzle. So, I just want to see the notes. there's a lot of stuff here, sorry. How do I touch? Can I get some help here? I want to move this up. Sorry, this is the loading animation for this slide. One of our hunt goals, or rather high-level goals for this puzzle, was to deliver an experience that was different, unusual, and unexpected from the standard meta puzzle that people, solvers, would normally expect from the first hour or two of the hunt. And we hope we achieve that goal by making you look at something that you probably weren't looking too closely at. Secondly, we also wanted to reward observant teams by granting them access to the factory faster than usual. So it was technically possible to break out into the factory with just one puzzle solve. All you had to do was look at the animation and think very hard about what could be happening. In practice, we saw teams break out to the factory in about 7 solves. I think there was one team that did it in 6 solves. I don't think we saw any teams that did it faster than that. And lastly, the goal of hiding a puzzle in plain sight was pretty interesting. to us. In particular, I think we were pretty happy that we got away with making a pun on the words loading puzzle. So in addition to loading being a verb in the sense that you're loading a puzzle, we also play off the definition of the word loading as a noun modifier, where you say, this is actually a puzzle about loading. So now I'll talk a bit about a couple of metas in the museum round. So these metas, if you've been through the museum, they tend to be a bit easier than the other metas that showed up in the hunt. So if I tried to explain some of the metas, that occur later in the hunt, we'd be here till Tuesday. So I'm just going to stick with a couple of slides for each one. So in the Natural History Museum, you saw 8 puzzles, each puzzle resolving to a very a string that could clue a word or a phrase that started with T and a dash. So in this case, you have abstract memes, and this is an example of something like that would be a T pose. This is in reference to this puzzle is in reference to the fact that the T Rex is also known as the king. So that would be your breaking point. And the way you solve this is to realize that the answers to each of these puzzles also included exactly 2 T's, and then you would just line them up with the word that was clued by the T word that was clued, and you realize that our curators were they winged it with the biggest exhibit in the Natural History Collection, just like how I'm winging this presentation right now. So the second meta we want to highlight was the artistic vision meta. Solvers would see basically a abstract art painting, which was basically made out of a green background and several lines. One thing you had to realize was that each of the answers in the round referenced something that had 1 or 2 colors associated with it. So for example, the Chicago White Sox, their logo is white and black. And secondly, you have, I'm not going to try pronouncing this word, it's a Polish ceramics. If you solve the puzzle, that's what the first answer in this list is. Just type of Polish ceramics, and if you see the image, you can kind of guess that white and blue are the 2 primary colors involved here. So what solvers would do is you would go into the abstract art painting and take the lines that intersected, 2 lines that intersected that have the 2 colors for each puzzle answer, and when you take them across, take a union across all intersections that satisfy the answers, you would get a Braille message that would read, seeing double rainbow. So I want to move on to the puzzle factory. So this is where you would stay. You would get after breaking out. So if you recall, there'll be a hall of monitors on the left. And then as you scroll, as you solve more puzzles, you would unlock even more puzzles, and you could see more of the factory, and if you solve enough puzzles, you could unlock a staircase to the office, and then after a while to the basement as well. So we have 3 separate tracks in the museum, in the factory, that would require you to basically solve puzzles in this fashion. So I won't be talking about the office and basement metas because there's no time for that. But I also want to point out the blueprint meta is one of the metas of all time, for sure. If you haven't solved it, you should definitely do that. Looking up the solution would be a disservice to the amount of time that our authors have put into the puzzle. Also, I want to highlight the Hall of Innovation. So this is one of our kind of more of experimental rounds. It involved puzzles that were not necessarily static. They had their answers were kind of constrained or modified by the configurations of certain gizmos in the factory. And as you solve or as you move through the factory and touched certain dials or added certain numbers to screens or letters to things like that in the factory, you would change the presentation of the puzzle. And I think while solving the puzzle, you might realize that your answers keep getting cleared. I think this is something that people probably run into quite a lot, and it's part of the natural solve path. And this is definitely also one of the more interesting metas in our rounds in our hunt. So I don't want to give away too much here either, because firstly, that's a lot. It's quite a puzzle, quite a round, I would say. Yeah, the solution is very long and it spans basically nine pages. So we probably also don't want to get into that. So I think that is where I'm gonna stop talking because I think Patrick is gonna talk about reactivation.
Hello, thanks Brian. So after you explored the factory and the museum and you've learned enough about what teammates been doing and how mates been feeling, you end up with reactivation. And so in reactivation, as Leah mentioned earlier, we're trying to discover the names of the AIs that were rejected. And so in this puzzle, you have some drives with some images and some files. And in this particular one, I will talk about this particular drive with these images or figures drawn and these instructions, which are strange words, total related. And it turns out that these are, it's a cryptogram where each of these words, these total words are replacing a word from the total graphics programming language. And when you run that code, it generates these nice figures. So you figure out which of the words, total words, correspond to which of the keywords in the programming language. And for the final four down there, you run it and it draws out worm. And so for this particular drive, you would submit worm. And if you do this for all four of them, you will discover the names of all four of the AIs. And doing so will lead a teammate to show up in your room with the shutdown of the factory. So beyond that, as you slowly reopen the factory, or as you slowly find and meet these AIs, each of these AIs, they were rejected for a reason. They had strange gimmicks or interesting round structure, and so we don't have time to get into the details of how their like metas worked, but I do want to talk about the how the round structure differs from what a normal round, like the museum rounds, might be. So the first is worm. Worm had a cyclic round structure. So you start off with the puzzles from a couple puzzles from the museum that have a meta puzzle, and after solving that meta puzzle, you are given a few more puzzles, and using that meta puzzle plus those few other puzzles, you can solve another meta puzzle. And so this goes in layers. And on the last layer, you discover that the meta puzzle for these puzzles was actually a puzzle from the very beginning. And so it's not very easy to explain, but it's very clear to see from this picture that the round kind of, it's infinitely loops. The second AI is Admiral Booties. And again, this is a non-standard round. Normally in puzzle hunts, you would expect answers are a single word or phrase. It's maybe you ignore spaces, you would ignore punctuation, and that is not what Admiral Booties wants in its round, in their round. Instead, the answers are multi-line and include punctuation. For example, one of the answers was L.A., one of E. Cummings' poems, and the other is a quote from War Games. And the meta puzzle here involves using the spacing in a 2D way, so it's kind of not something you can do with normal answers. The third AI is I, and in I's round, or in Ascent, all the answers are not in English. So this let us construct puzzles that were not targeting English either. For example, one of the puzzles was in Singlish, it was a crossword, with Singlish clues. So you might read it at first and say, oh, I know this language, until you read it more closely and realize you really don't know the language. another example is an Arabic word search. Again, you might be familiar with word searches. We all know word searches, I think. But when you start, if you don't know Arabic letters, then you start to struggle communicating with your teammates which letter is which. And beyond looking at the language itself, some puzzles also looked at history, culture, or geography of the languages. So one example is this traditional chess puzzle. It's based on Chaturanga, which is the like ancestor of all these chess variants we have these days. And again, you might think, oh, I know how to solve a chess puzzle. It's a mate in one, like the queen moves diagonally. All of that is normal. Not quite in this game either. The last AI is a Conjury, and Conjury's round is, again, not a normal round. Each puzzle is a normal puzzle, but you can't really access the puzzles. You have to play the game. And in the game, it's a roguelike. You travel around, and you find chests which contain puzzles, and solving those puzzles gives you keys, which lets you reach more chests. You also have to fight monsters. These monsters are small tasks like Minesweeper or Math Problem. And each run, each playthrough of the game, you see different puzzles. So you have to play the game many times. You also have to earn gold, buy items, beat the boss, all these things that you would do in a normal game in the course of solving the round. So finally, after you have solved all the found the feature requests for all of these AIs, you go to assemble Mate's team. And in this puzzle, you're given a series of clues. They're of varying types, like images or audio clips. And these are all from earlier puzzles in the puzzle hunt. So you would go back, find them, click on them, earn a jigsaw piece, and reassemble this jigsaw with all the AIs on it, and each jigsaw piece can be transformed into a single letter, and so reading the letters gives you the final assembled answer of solve for the greatest common factory. And with that, I'll pass it back to one of the directors, Brian.
Thanks. Yep, so I guess before we started with developing Mystery Hunt, this being our first time writing as teammate, we set out to identify some of the goals that we wanted to have for this hunt. And I think the overarching idea is that we wanted to bring to Mystery Hunt something that was uniquely teammate. And I think so some of the ways in which some of the values that we had were being able to construct unique and memorable puzzles, experimenting with different round structures. I mean, I don't know who else who would be crazy enough to write puzzles that feed not only two metas but also two meta-metas. And then we also, I think we, we have some perfectionists among us, and definitely like really wanted to have this to be high production value, building upon different aspects of the art, on the tech, putting everything together. And overall, I think we strive to be able to bring together something to help smaller teams and less intense teams, and to be able to aid them in the ways that we can. Additionally, I guess like some of the other things that we've had discussed were to integrate stories to part of the experience, also just to have camaraderie amongst the team. I've gotten to know a lot of teammates much closer this year as we prepare for this, like especially in the leading months up to this event, as it became more and more just all the time. but I think it was well worth it too. and I hope that you guys next year find yourselves in the same way. And despite how things may have turned out, we imagined, at least up through some point, that we were riding a smaller hunt. I mean, there were only approximately 150 puzzles, which is a from our perspective, was a step down from recent years. But things seem to turn out otherwise. But yeah, with that said, that's really all I have here. And I'll pass it off to Jackie, who is our creative lead, to tell you a little bit about some of the story and art that we had.
Hey. Yeah, so first I'll just tell you about some of our goals we had, especially within the story and art team for this hunt. The top one is just to integrate the story closely with the solving experience. We always love that when you're solving a puzzle, it sort of feels like you are advancing the plot, and you don't have to go somewhere else to read the story to keep track of what's going on. We wanted to integrate them and make that as fluid as possible. Some story-specific things, we wanted to make solvers the drivers of important events rather than other characters where possible. We wanted metas and interactions to include actual narrative surprises and be sort of plot advancing. And we wanted to find a way to tie the sort of off-theme rounds that we wanted to have back into the overall plot. Art-wise, we wanted to use art to sort of seamlessly integrate the story and achieve that first goal of tying the story in with the structure and the solving experience. And we also wanted to feature a wide range of art styles. Teammate is fortunate enough to have a lot of really talented artists that we wanted to make use of and give them a chance to work on something they were excited about. So, yeah, okay. one thing we did to sort of get the story injected into the solving experience was put these chatbot characters on a lot of the puzzle pages. For one thing, we just put them sort of in place of where you traditionally have copy to clipboard or some other tools. We tried to give them a lot of expressions and make them feel engaging. A lot of those became reactions in our Discord. And we also tried to make them sort of convey the progress of a story as it went in some cases. Like Worm started out very small and grew longer with every layer as they sort of gained confidence. And their dialogue was all written to convey their specific character and also their state, like Worm's confidence or Mate's anxiety. Next was sort of establishing a really cohesive environment and setting in the factory in particular. The factory is really where we put the bulk of our story immersion effort, where the other AI rounds were a little more like typical puzzle hunts. So we had this whole factory assembly line, which was constrained by certain puzzle things, and we also wanted to make each machinery relate to its puzzle wherever possible. And for those of you who didn't see it or didn't spend much time here, we leaned into a point-and-click aesthetic, making all the puzzles be actual objects in the factory and tying that to their flavor wherever possible. So just for some examples, there was an audio puzzle with this little interactive cassette tape. We put a lot of our flavor text in these message boxes to lean into this idea that you're just exploring and here's what you found, what do you do with it? We had a wheel up there. I put reactivation on here again, just as a culmination of a really tight story and puzzle integration. You found the files in the office, found drives in the basement. Now it's time to put them together. So it's really like narratively a meta as well as just using what you've already found. Back to the factory environment. This was something else that sort of changed over time, and we wanted to convey the current status of things, convey the story. So it was all active and it was active when you were exploring it the first time. Then after the shutdown, we wanted the darkness to be really striking. Everything stopped moving. And gradually over time, as you helped the AIs out and generated some more power to wake more up, it got more bright and colorful. And here's all the feature requests integrated into the animations. One more thing we did, in the interest of sort of not making people go to the story page to seek out the story and just putting it right in front of them wherever possible, was something we called story cards that we used in a few places. So for example, in this meta, In the office, you'd be looking through the filing cabinet, get the answer pen multiple mates, and immediately on submitting it, up comes the story card, sort of clarifying it, a one-frame explanation, so that people who solve it can get that story content presented right to them. And then, sort of optionally, this was interactable. You could read the files, so people could choose to engage with the story at different levels as they wanted to. And then some of our story cards were especially interactive. We had a few digital interactions. So these were synchronous conversations with the AIs, where solvers could get on at the same time and vote on what they wanted their team to be saying in response, and get real dynamic feedback and expressions from the AI. And each of these, or many of these, also conditioned on what information you already had to present the most realistic and the most new information possible. Yeah, so now I'm gonna talk a little bit more about the art for each round and just credit the art team because we had a really great art team. So the museum was the first part of the hunt and we tried to keep all of that in a similar sort of flat, clean, polished art style. The leads for that are Katie Dunn, Katie Chung, and Jillian Tang. Yeah. And yeah, we just tried to make each round have a unique flavor, but still fit within this aesthetic that you could imagine Mate was writing all of these and it would stand apart from the other things later. The factory, art leads Olga Vinogradova, Tracy Lin, and me. and mostly them. here, this was all part of that immersion, the storytelling like we talked about. Here, there was a lot of Easter eggs. In the office in particular, we were going for sort of the current hunt Easter eggs. So some of the physical puzzles appear there, our team shirts in boxes, weird motivational posters that sort of highlight teammates' perfectionism. And in the basement, we went for Easter eggs from past hunts, like Talk the Puppet, old core memories, and those piggy banks from which we got our mascot. oh my gosh, the cats, yes, thank you. Some, but not all, of teammates' pet cats ended up getting sort of embedded in the factory as Easter eggs, too. Definitely a lot of cat people, especially on the factory team. Wormhole, art leads Ariel Wee, Sarah Wu, and Audrey Fashionpar. Something that was really, this was a particularly constraining round art-wise. Some stuff we were given when we were brainstorming was, it's gonna be an infinite loop, it's gonna be mathy, fractally, geometry, the character's name is Worm, and also one of the layers is all puzzles that were already in the museum. So, oh, and we had flavor for each layer too, like optics for the kaleidoscope and aquatics for the fish. So we were really trying to incorporate as much of that as possible into the art, and we ended up landing on this sort of arts and crafts aesthetic. It was Audrey who did Worm's character art, whose idea was to turn them into an Ouroboros at the infinite loop. Yeah, so that's just a little that went into this. It was tricky making the loop, but. Okay, then for Admiral Booties, the lead is Herman Chow. And here, ASCII art was a really sort of natural choice given the nature of like positioning letters in the answers in this round. So we think it did a really great job. And of course, yeah, especially with making the cat so expressive with just what ASCII art provides, I was really impressed. Yeah, so this is I, Mona Wang. This was one of the less constrained rounds from a like puzzle integration perspective, so we could just kind of be a little more free and organic with the art style. We were told It's about multiple languages and cultures. It's got a tower theming in the meta, and the AI's name is I. So that led us to this idea of like biblically accurate angel and the Tower of Babel. Yeah, it's a, where we tried to incorporate different sort of architectural styles from around the world to lean into that rounds gimmick, and also incorporate elements of the puzzles in each of the layers as well, or at least nod to them. And then finally, Conjury's Quest, our art lead Jun Kuo. This was, there was a lot of art here, especially with little characters animations, little icons. It took a lot to make the whole thing play like a game, but I was also really impressed. And finally, I just want to say a big thank you to our tech team, because like without their help, none of this would be possible, and it was really great when we were brainstorming art and creative aspects to be able to know we could dream really big, and we could ask them for infinite looping art or parallax scrolling, and it would probably be possible. It was just a real privilege to work with them. And now I'll pass it on to our logistics lead, Moore, to talk about events.
So we had 4 events throughout Friday and Saturday, and these events represent parts of the Museum of Interesting Things, which was our original cover theme. And our goals in the events were to provide events that were integrated into the hunt, but provide a way for puzzlers to, you know, get out of the room, do something a little bit different. We wanted a diverse set of events, allowing teams to interact with other teams and participate in ways that were light and fun and different than what they would be doing in what you are all doing in your team bases. So that was the goal. There was a particular emphasis on allowing all of you to interact with people that you don't normally work with, right? We all have our teams that we work with, and we wanted you to be able to meet some people from other teams. And I think all of our events were able to accomplish this in some way. So going through our 4 events, we started off with art restoration. So as part of the museum, you're restoring art. So teams needed to restore art by communicating with incomplete information with other solvers around their table. And they needed to do various things like fold a butterfly, so origami, draw some pictures that you had to overlay with each other, and reconstruct the collage. And here are some examples of the productions from various teams. In the coffee shop on Saturday morning, solvers had to realize after they arrived at the coffee shop that they needed to partner up with 3 other teams to get the whole puzzle. And it turned into an escape room style event in which there were 3 mini puzzles and a meta in which solvers had to figure out what the correct drink would be to order, since the baristas seemed to be out of literally everything. And as part of this event, participants received coffee and hot chocolate, and a special shout out to the MIT Lab for Chocolate Science for assisting us with the hot chocolate. We had another event, 2 Friends and a Troll. In this event, players played a word association game with other teams. And you found out that some people on your teams were supportive friends, and some were trolls. So this was an interesting adversarial challenge, which hopefully a lot of you were able to enjoy. And our last event was called Teammating Dances. So participants needed to participate in a study to simulate mating dances of various animals. And the participants acted as animals to learn a mating dance associated with a particular species. And then they needed to find the members of their flock or hive to find their mates. So I think we have a video. So So, so we're happy to see our sovereigns act as animals and do something light and fun, and that was really the goal of all of our events. And we're really happy to see the participation, the enthusiasm to get out of the room and do something fun for an hour and then to go back to puzzles. And with that, I think I'm going to hand it over to Ariel, who's going to talk about the runaround.
Hello. I was one of the authors on the final runaround, along with Jackie and Abhijit and a few other people. So the final runaround was a series of mini interactive puzzles based on each AI's final meta puzzle answer. And the solvers would run around to various places in this building, solve the interactive puzzle, and then receive a gear, which we'll see pictures of later. So I'm going to go through them fairly quickly, but we started out with Worm, which was a large hexaflexagon puzzle where solvers had to put together different pieces of the hexaflexagon in order for them to match, and then they would receive Worm's gear. Moving on, we went to Conjuries part of the runaround, which was a game of red light, green light with a twist where random other colors would come up and the solvers would have to figure out what to do, culminating in them having to hop diagonally towards the front while holding on to each other. Next, we moved on to Admiral Booty's runaround, where the solvers had to play a game of anti-gravity charades, where they had to act out space scenes while keeping balloons in the air. Next, we came to Eyes runaround, where the solvers had to pass different messages to each other, which were in the various languages used in this round. But they had to describe them verbally to each other and then re-record them. So here is an example of what the messages turned into. Finally, each of those rounds gave solvers a gear, which was designed to look like that round. And each gear also had a number on it. And for mate's part, the final mate answer is to solve for the greatest common factory. So we had to figure out that's what we needed to do, look at all of the gears and their numbers, take the greatest common factory, and then mate's gear was locked to the outside of our HQ, also locking it shut. And once they could find the greatest common factor, which was 2023, we could unlock the gear, enter HQ. Yeah, so now that the solvers can enter the puzzle factory, we had a bunch of decorative conveyor belts designed to look like the factory art that we saw earlier. And we had a nice factory monitor bank set up in real life that the teams who were on the final runaround could interact with a little. So once we have all the gears, the solvers could place them onto this big machine and turn a crank.
Ready.
Yes, so turning the crank a bunch of times eventually dumps out this puzzle box, which is the puzzle that you've created once you've collected all of the gears from the AIs. And inside this puzzle box is the Mystery Hunt 2023 coin. The team formerly known as blah, 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 team to be named later. Would you like to come up at this time? So if you haven't heard, this team to be named later, they were the first ones to solve the final meta puzzle, the first ones to go on the runaround and receive the coin. So congratulations. And just to talk a little bit about the design of the coin, on the first side, that this represents like the different puzzles in the factory, or sorry, the different puzzles in the hunt. So in the middle, we have Mate, which is the museum puzzles, and then the four rounds that were created by the four AIs. And then on the back, we have the representation of the puzzle factory, which was the hidden area that you weren't really supposed to be in. You guys can sit down now. And now I'm going to pass it back off to Kat to talk about puzzle highlights.
Cool. So this is a very inappropriately named section because these are not by any means all of the highlights that happened over the course of Hunt. They're not even most of them. They're a small, small section of what we saw in HQ. I'll just go through a few of them. So first we had a puzzle about quilting, where in the end we ask you to submit dresses design. So MIT Mystery Verified Blue Checkmark, who had a green checkmark in their name, turned in this submission, which was very cool, and then followed it up with this submission, which was even cooler. We also heard that y'all enjoyed the Morb puzzle. I don't think you enjoyed it quite as much as this team. Thank you for sending this in. We enjoyed it a lot. The other submission puzzle that we had was to ask you to record a tirade and send it in to us. Over here, we have a compilation of some of the tirades you received. So I'm gonna let you guys just sit back and enjoy.
And they should be better.
You know what? I hate Microsoft Teams. It is a terrible software that does not work well for collaborating across organizations.
This is woke culture run amok. They're trying to cancel Bean.
And this idiot sits up in his castle of art thinking he knows something, but he doesn't.
Oh, wow. That looks so good. Do you need a composer? Do you need a composer?
I will wipe your errata the f*** out with precision the likes of which has never been seen before on this earth. Mark my f- words.
If I make all my fans do f- numerology to try to decipher whether Jake Gyllenhaal jilted me in the spring of 2008.
Stop trying to be something more than you are. Everybody just wants to send money.
You know how many games I can buy for $25?
Do you think there's some secret government agency that decides whether or not museums are official or not?
This is more of a museum of insufferable things.
And we came from Arkansas just to let you know that it ain't about computers, it's about the human brain, hearts, blood, sweat, tears.
And starts making puzzles with unclued anagrams. And I can't handle it!
Which is not nearly enough in order to solve your impossible, impossible puzzles about things like useless war games and, what is something else? And Fire Emblem battle strategies.
And they'll tell you, oh, it wasn't anything real. It was made up by some hive god who wants to mess with you.
Anna's taqueria closed, which is even more bull. Thanks, Obama.
No. That was decided months ago, possibly by cave people or Mothman.
I think you got the radical left and the puzzle industrial complex, and probably China is involved somehow, and they're all conspiring together to ruin our hunt and take away our good old-fashioned traditional crossword puzzles.
Unskippable, like 5-second animation,
of a beaver.
And your teeth move, and they hurt, and everything sucks, and also they put spikes on your teeth.
It's like, how do you keep finding places to put 3D printed teeth?
What's going on? My kid, I asked if she has her pants on.
Bill Gates should have been arrested the moment that Minesweeper was put in front of my kids, let me tell you.
Also, calling someone a noob or a feeder, it's not one or the other. That's not how taxonomy works. They're both. A wyvern is a wyvern and a member of the dragon family.
Let me tell you about My Little Pony. Rachel is magic.
Like, why are we even doing paleo? The Neanderthals died for a reason.
You haven't figured out that we have hundreds, thousands of different places that you can put your arms with your silly little flag.
I'm gonna see if you can find some way to actually...
Cape and honey, you gotta do your dishes.
What?
Thank you to everyone who submitted a tirade. One of the other puzzles that people had a lot of fun with was Hall of Archaeology. Some of y'all might have been more fresh than others, but I think overall, y'all did pretty well. I want to call out some highlights of teams who were either very, very good or very, very bad at the puzzle. No shame either way. But yeah, kudos to all of you. I'm going to be honest, I have no idea how this puzzle works, but I'm realizing apparently that five flags is either really good or really bad. Can't tell. We also sent people to your rooms to watch you fail at clicking squares, or in many cases succeed at clicking squares, in a Think Fast challenge. Some of y'all had some pretty creative strategies. There was one level where instead of counting the numbers up from 1 through 12 as you'd expect, you had to alphabetize the numbers as you wrote them out and then click on them in that order. One team decided that each person would be assigned a number and then sort themselves in alphabetical order in order to better figure out the order and not have to remember it. There's another team whose picture is not up here who decided to arrange the chairs in a 6x6 grid, sit in the chairs, and point at each other, recreating the grid itself. And then finally, no hunt, apparently, is complete without a scavenger hunt, which hopefully reminded y'all to go outside, get some fresh air, and really enjoy the world outside of Mystery Hunt, even just for a little bit. maybe you found it impossible. So there were a ton of submissions that came in. We pulled a few of the more popular ones. Some of y'all really liked writing tweets. I don't know what that cat is saying, but I appreciate it because we like cats. Also, y'all really, really liked drawing Pokemon, and you're also really good at it. Like, every single person who submitted Pokemon was just amazing. We also had an early morning shift come in and wake up to some knocking on the door, expecting a physical pickup, as one does when one visits HQ, and instead came to this protest outside their doors. The way I heard it told, they slammed the door in the faces, and then the protesters continued to protest until our physical puzzle manager came out again. Cool. So I'm going to move on to some of the stats that's about the hunt. First, I'm going to talk about us, because I like talking about us. Overall, as Brian mentioned, we had 152 total puzzles, which we thought was a very small number. There were 18 metas, 3 capstones, 4 events, and 1 scavenger hunt. So hopefully y'all enjoyed all of those. This is what our writing graph looked like. As you can see, We're very good at procrastinating. Let's just say we haven't had a lot of sleep in the past, like, 3 weeks. Okay, on to you all. So, over the course of Hunts, we had 301 teams registered, 4,500 people people total, and 1,700 of y'all on campus. So, it's a pretty crazy turnout. I won't read through all of these, but I do want to call out that we had close to 5,000 hints answered, which was really driven by this amazing team answering all of your hints at all times, except for sometimes 3 to 6 when we decided we needed to sleep. We had 32 teams reach reactivation, which we considered the midpoints of our hunt. We're very happy now that so many of you made it that far and got to experience the story to that point. We hope you enjoyed us barging into your rooms and occasionally shutting off your lights. And then finally, kudos to the 8 teams that finished. Then the picture y'all have been waiting for. This was, and as is probably typical, it's very hard to see because the font is very small, but this was an incredibly close hunt. Till the end, we were calling, I think, 5 or 6 teams trying to figure out which of you is actually going to solve these metas faster. It's pretty much impossible to tell, but at the end, it was extremely close. So kudos to everyone who finished and made it that far. I assume y'all got your pictures of it so you can analyze it properly when you get back. So a few records. First team to solve run around, obviously the... the team formerly known as a 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 team to be named later. Who then proceeded to get first on most of the other AI metas as well. But also call out to Galactic Trendsetters for being the very first to... Guys, I just read the entire thing! Give me some slack! Sorry. whoosh, Galactic Trendsetters, nyar! For being the first to solve reactivation, as well as the MIT Mystery Hunt validated check for being the first to solve the booties meta. Cool. Now I'll pass it off to Moya to talk about and thank all our very generous sponsors.
All right, thank you there, Kat. My name is Moya. I hope you guys are all having fun with this wrap-up, and I'm going to talk a little bit about sponsors. As was mentioned earlier, MIT Mystery Hunt is a very large event with about 4,000 people participating total and 1,700 people on-site. It took a lot of work to organize, and covering the cost of physical puzzles, event spaces, and props, as the team to be named later will find out, is not very cheap. And so to this end, we want to give a little bit of a very important time to thank our amazing sponsors who helped make this event possible. First and foremost, at our top feature level tiers, we have all of our sponsors that will whose logos will be on our official t-shirts. Just reading a little bit about them. Jane Street is a New York-based quantitative trading firm and liquidity provider with a unique focus on technology and collaborative problem solving. This will be the 5th year in a row that they have graciously supported our community. So thank y'all for giving a warm round of applause for that. Secondly, at this tier, HRT is a math and technology company consisting of engineers and researchers working as one team to solve difficult problems. HRT trades millions of shares a day on the world's financial markets. This is HRT's second year in a row that they have graciously supported our community, so let's give them a round of applause for them as well. Cool. So next, at our sponsor tier, we have three organizations. So SIG is a global quantitative trading firm founded with a growth mindset and an analytical approach to decision making. As one of the largest proprietary trading firms in the world, SIG brings together the brightest minds, the best technology, and an extensive library of data to design and implement quantitative trading strategies and implement quantitative trading strategies and provide liquidity to the markets and ensure competitive prices for buyers and sellers. So, yep. Next, we have Two Sigma. Two Sigma is a New York City-based firm that uses rigorous inquiry, data analysis, and invention to help solve the toughest challenges across financial services. Please visit their careers page at careers.twosigma.com to explore all of Two Sigma's offerings for students and to find out more about their people, their culture, and their work. And then lastly on this slide, the MIT Museum strives to be a place where science, technology, the humanities, and the arts are all used to frame and reframe problems, enabling it to address the compelling questions of our time in new ways. So the MIT Museum, they were the ones that graciously gave us all of the tickets for the trip to the museum puzzle, as well as extended access to their space. The MIT Museum has worked with Mystery Hunts in previous years as well, and so we greatly appreciate their collaboration and their support. Cool. And then for our corporate sponsors, last but not least, at our contributing tier, we have Dropbox. And then also, in addition to everything else, you have to give special thanks to all of you. And in case you guys are interested in donating right now, the QR code to the official donation link is on the slide here. And donating via this link will greatly help the team to be named later when they run Hunt next year. Good luck. Community participation is basically key to the success of Mystery Hunt. In addition to support from all of from MIT and all of the corporate partners, donations from those in the community have been vital in funding this event, especially as it grows in scale. With the exception of COVID, this event has basically grown bigger every single year. Us actually helping fund it really does help keep it alive. Donations by those from the community for the community are by far the single largest donor to MIT Mystery Hunt every year, and we can't thank everyone enough for the support. So, yeah. And so with that note, I'm now going to hand the things off to Lumia, who will be talking a little bit for MIT Puzzle Club.
Hello. So as some people in this room might be able to tell, Mystery Hunt was in person this year. There were a lot of logistics that needed to be done. So special thanks to all of these groups. And if you want to help us with anything related to future Mystery Hunts, there are several things you could do. If you're a student, you can come to any of Puzzle Club's events. We normally host several events per semester. Otherwise, you can donate at the link that was posted earlier. Oh, yeah, we also have merch for sale.
So that concludes a wrap up. And with that, Mystery Hunt 2023 is officially over.
And now we can all go home and get some proper sleep. All right. Thank you all, guys. Solutions are unfortunately not quite available yet, but they will be released shortly when they are when they are available and the tech is ready for it. Are you ready to do it? Yep.
About some of the extra coins, especially because we have people that are going home and wanted to bring it to the